a tape that has been hidden for many years by the government, secret services, whoever, of Leon Britton abusing young boys. So it isn't just Tony Blair's government, it's Margaret Thatcher's government. And Leon Britton, I'll say it again, was a regular visitor to Elm Guest House at the same time as Gary Walker, who was heavily a leader of Sinn Féin and the IRA, while bombs were going off on the streets of this country. I'm sorry, I'm getting angry now. While bombs were going off on the streets in this country, and people were being accused of this and that, while these two, our Home Secretary and the leader of Sinn Féin and the IRA, were messing about with children at Elm Guest House and worse. And we're now going into the detail of snuff movies. A witness I'm working with was asked if he knew anything about a snuff movie where a young child was decapitated. So it's going a lot deeper, Lou, and I asked Nick Clegg that question 4 years ago, Lou.
Yeah. Bill, can we just quickly go on? What happened on the BBC this morning? Because obviously I came straight into the studio and I've just been...
Thumbs up.
Nick, 4 years ago I asked you what were you going to do about institutional paedophile operating in this country now? Your reply to me, Nick, was, I don't know what you mean by institutional paedophile rings. Do you understand what I was talking about 4 years ago now, Nick? And stay in my eyes.
Well, they're naming Cyril Smith and they're saying the Liberal Democrat leader, the Liberal Democrat Party and the Labour Party have got questions to answer about paedophilia, institutional paedophilia within councils, within government.
Okay.
And he's banging on their door now, Lou.
So hang on a minute.
They can't hide anymore.
No, they can't hide.
Lou, can I just say that this is all because of victims that are coming forward. So you victims that are out there, you come forward because you're now witnesses. And, you know, this fight, we're taking this right into the heart. We are in the battlefield now, and swords and sabres are clashing.
Absolutely.
And we will not back down.
No, I mean, we
as
also...
victims and survivors of institutional child abuse, the people, when your audience, Lou, when they start watching the news today and they see what's happening, they will understand my temperament at the moment, if you like.
Absolutely.
And that's what I would like to say to all you institutional paedophile rings that are happening, that were involved in these atrocities that were happening. We said we're coming to get you, and it's not even started yet.
Now, the Labour MP for Rochdale, Simon Danchuk, recently published a book, Smile for the Camera, The Double Life of Cyril Smith. It detailed his investigation into allegations of child abuse surrounding his Liberal predecessor. Now he's been contacted by those involved in other investigations. And today he spoke to our reporter Becky Milligan about those investigations and the effect they've had on him.
Listening to some of the stories, but I make this point, it's never as harrowing as what the victims have been through. We have regular conversations with people who've ended up on drugs. You know, it's really ruined their lives. We hear about people who've committed suicide, and so when people say, oh, these victims are just coming forward to try and get some compensation, let me tell you, all the money in the world sorry.
That's all right, Simon. I know it's really harrowing. Are you okay?
The Rochdale MP, Simon Danchuk, talking to our reporter, Becky Milligan, earlier.
To
another story, and the Jimmy Savile sex scandal at the BBC and with the police is rumbling on. Seven times, apparently, the police let Jimmy Savile off. That's the headlines of many of the newspapers today. But this was raised on Wednesday by Tom Watson in the House of Commons at Prime Minister's Questions. And if you listen carefully, you can hear a lot of the Conservative people at the very beginning, when Tom Watson stands up to speak, making sort of animal noises at him. But anyway, let's hear what he had to say.
Watson!
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The evidence file used to convict paedophile Peter Wrighton, if it still exists, contains clear intelligence of a widespread paedophile ring. One of its members boasts of his links to a senior aide of a former Prime Minister, who says he could smuggle indecent images of children from abroad. The leads were not followed up, but if the files still exist, I want to ensure that the Metropolitan Police secure the evidence, re-examine it, and investigate clear intelligence suggesting a powerful paedophile network linked to Parliament and Number 10.
But the most prominent paedophile associated with the Savile ring was a man called Edward Heath, who, you may recall, was Prime Minister and took us into the EEC. Heath was into little boys, and Savile was supplying them. A number of these boys were taken out of the Haute de Garenne home in Jersey. Savile was taking children from a children's home with the support of German assets in Jersey. What was happening was that children's homes in the Channel Islands, particularly Haute de Garenne in Jersey, children were being taken from these homes, boys in the case of Herbert Heath, as he was gay, and a paedophile, were being taken onto his yacht, the Morning Cloud. Savile was actually going out to, he went down to Jersey, and he was actually taking boys. There was another man involved as well, but Savile himself took boys from the children's home, where he was a guest, or welcome, onto the boat. So he was taking boys out onto Morning Cloud. Now, since Heath is well known, and since the boys were talking young men, the boys were murdered and thrown off the boat. That's why the BBC and the Cabinet Office have been so keen to protect Savile. That's why the Cabinet Office in the 1980s were willing to back Savile to the point of giving him a position of authority at Broadmoor, which is an absolute, you know, you don't put a paedophile in charge of Broadmoor. The Cabinet Secretary at the time, who thankfully is no longer with us, Hunt, was also a paedophile, was in on this, met Savile. He was Catholic, met Savile, as did that very nice man, the late Archbishop of Westminster, Cardinal Basil Hume. Basil was not a paedophile, but knew Hunt and had a shrewd idea. He wasn't stupid, he had a shrewd idea of what had been going on, and I've no doubt was told to keep a lid on it. Hunt was in on it, so the Cabinet Secretary at the time was in on it, was aware of what was going on, was aware he had a Prime Minister who was involved not just in abusing young boys, but was murdering them as well. It's quite possible that there was a crewman on the yacht who did the actual murder. I'm not saying it, but Heath necessarily bashed the boys on the boco and tossed them overboard. He may have had somebody do that for him, but he was certainly guilty of murder under English law as an accessory or on a joint enterprise basis. Oh, if someone is inclined in that direction and you can supply them with boys, then you've got a hold on them, or girls. There's nothing worse for a politician than being exposed in the murder and sexual abuse of young people. And if you've got a politician who is abusing and killing young girls and boys, but boys or girls, then you've got a hold on them. Paedophilia is a wonderful means, if you're a hostile intelligence agency, of blackmailing politicians. The reason it's particularly disgusting, quite aside from the element of sexual abuse and coercion and corruption of young people, that's disgusting in and of itself. But what makes it particularly vile, and we saw this in the Madeleine McCann case, and that's why the Madeleine McCann case was so heartbreaking and tragic. If the children are, and I'm afraid with paedophilia we sometimes have babies being abused, but if you're not talking babies, if you're talking toddlers who are able to recognize the people who are abusing them, since the people, there's absolutely no point doing it unless the politician is high profile. Since you're talking about people who are on television, people who are high profile, you have to murder the children in order to protect your asset. So for the Germans, it was essential that the boys that were being taken onto the yacht, that was a death ride. When Jimmy Savile was taking, let's say, a 14-year-old boy down to Morning Cloud, handing him over to Edward Heath or a member of the crew on the yacht, it was a death ride. That was that boy's last journey on Earth.
Over recent days, the Daily Mail has splashed its front pages about the Labour deputy leader, her husband, Shadow Minister Jack Dromey, and the former Labour Health Secretary, Patricia Hewitt. All three worked for the National Council for Civil Liberties in the 1970s and 80s. The council, now known as the human rights organisation Liberty, was linked to the Paedophile Information Exchange, a group which campaigned for paedophiles' rights. It even argued to lower the age of consent to 10. Ms. Harman became the legal officer at the NCCL in 1978, and her name appears on documents submitted to the Home Office that argued that pictures of naked children should not be banned as indecent unless it could be proved that the child had been harmed.
All right, Harman, you were the legal officer for several years at the National Council for Civil Liberties, which was affiliated to the Paedophile Information Exchange. Why was it acceptable even to have an affiliation? They didn't try to hide what they were. The title of the group was the Paedophile Information Exchange. Why was it okay for them even to have any link with the group you worked for? At the time when you were the legal officer there, you wrote in a briefing paper to MPs, and we have it here, that prosecutions in relation to child protection and photography should only proceed if you can prove that children were actually harmed. Can you see why people might raise an eyebrow? Was the affiliation between the two groups a mistake?
Well, NCCL takes money from any organisation which was a lawful organisation and any individual.
You're happy that your employer for 4 years took membership money from a group that was overtly campaigning for the rights of paedophiles. That wasn't a mistake. That's what you're saying.
You know, I stand by what I was doing at NCCL, and I stand by what I've done all the way through.
I encountered Kenneth Clark MP, and when I did so, when I met him at Ian Greer's office, he molested me. He put his hand on my penis and kept it there. They haven't spoken to Kenneth Clark MP, and they said they wouldn't be speaking to him because he was above the law. It was videotaped because it was the Cook Report. Mm. We videotaped everything. So we had a jacket camera and we had a suitcase camera. And when I was in the room, the suitcase camera, I think, went on the sofa opposite, and I had the jacket camera on. Now, you can't see anything with the jacket camera because obviously someone comes in and touches you that way, but on the suitcase camera, you saw it. And when I got the tapes back to the, we were staying in the place called the Hyde Park Residence, they played the tapes, and the producers sat there and they watched it, and I watched it. Mm. So I know that they knew that I'd been molested by Kenneth Clark MP. John Major knew what we were doing, found out about it, yeah? And got Carlton Television, Carlton Communications, to buy Central Television to get hold of the Cook Report tapes, to get hold of the tape of Kenneth Clark molesting me in Ian Greer's office as well. So these tapes were taken by Carlton Communications. John Major said, well, the scandal was so huge it was going to bring down the Conservative government. Got Carlton Communications, who was a client of Ian Greer at the time, to do him a favour, which was to buy Central Television, which we were planning to do anyway, but much later. Because they were going to buy sort of all the little small independent television stations.
So he could get that film footage.
To get that film footage. Now, the man who did the actual getting of the tapes was Prime Minister David Cameron. He worked for Carlton Communications. He was Michael Green, the CEO's right-hand man, and he handled it. So when the police went to David Cameron to say about questioning Kenneth Clark, guess what he said?
Downing Street is in hot water over allegations that it attempted to sweep under the rug the arrest of a close aide of the Prime Minister over a child pornography probe. The official, one of whose role was to advise online porn filters, was reportedly warned that police were investigating him hours before he was detained. RT's Laura Smith has the details.
His name is Patrick Rock, and he is in fact, though, a veteran Conservative Party advisor, David Cameron's deputy chief of staff. He's been called Cameron's fixer, and he's had what one might call unparalleled access to power over a very long time, over the last four decades, right there in the heart of government. The irony lies in the fact that he's also been closely involved in drawing up government policy on internet pornography filters, and this is a man who was arrested recently on suspicion of what everybody's calling an offence related to child abuse images. So not just pornography, but what appears to be child pornography. Now, his arrest happened on February the 12th and he then resigned, but this was all on the quiet. Downing Street appears to have covered it up until it was confronted with it now. So for the last 3 weeks, no one's known anything about this, but apart from the Prime Minister, who apparently has known for 3 weeks. He said he was very concerned that the matter should be handled correctly, that he didn't want to brief preemptively on a criminal investigation against a member of his staff. But his critics, who are mainly Labour members of Parliament, so opposition, say that this raises a number of questions. For example, what level of security did Patrick Rock have? Is there other stuff that we don't know about? It's also emerged, by the way, that Rock had previously been accused of sexual harassment, which was dealt with by his boss at Downing Street, so a political figure rather than a civil servant figure, not very usual. So again, some sort of oddity going on there. The Prime Minister's being accused of a cover-up, and his Labour critics say that this undermines the entire credibility and effectiveness of the government.
When are individual cases too much? When is pain too much? I can assure you I've seen enough individual cases, and there are at least one Belgian journalist who has seen enough individual cases, and there is one journalist, Christopher Booker, who writes regularly about individual cases. But nothing changes and nothing has changed in the UK. That's why we are here today. We are here crying for help. There are children screaming to be heard. If you don't hear those children scream, who will?
Let's just go straight into it,
Let's go straight into it.
The witness that I'm talking to from Operation Fernbridge made two films of Jimmy Savile.
Right.
Two very special films of Jimmy Savile. In one of those films, he was abusing a dead young girl in a mortuary. In the other film, he was filming a dead young boy.
That Sidney Cook was a friend.
With Jimmy Savile.
Of Jimmy Savile.
Robert Maxwell was a paedophile. And that is it. And Robert Maxwell is now dead. And Robert Maxwell, our witness, had actually had a sexual encounter with Robert Maxwell and been on his boat quite a few times and seen many, many powerful people there from the media, you know. It's a horrendous story. And then we've got a picture of Prince Andrew with his arm around an underage prostitute.
Charles
Napier.
Charles Napier was paedophile information exchange, because I've been looking since, you know, you and I had that kind of conversation about a month ago. I started looking who this Charles Napier was. I believe he had a boat, which kids would go onto the boat. A sailing boat, and then that people would
But they weren't
up.
Just any kids. He had Down syndrome kids and disabled kids on that boat. I believe that the Pilkingtons had something to do with the killing or the death of my brother Peter. So there you go, and that's the glass people. So you Pilkingtons out there, I hope there's at least one of you listening, and I'd love your lawyers to come and talk to me, and we can talk about Peter Maloney, my brother, who was found dead after, you know, Alistair Pilkington had been messing about with. If you look at the guy who's in charge, DCI Settle, he's the guy in charge of Operation Fernbridge.
Right.
That's his name, right? He's a detective inspector, Settle. He was head of the Royal Protection. He used to protect the Queen. Why are you there, Settle? Why are you there? Why have you told Andrew he's not allowed to talk about the royals? Why have you told Andrew that he's not to talk about the serving politician or the serving chancellor? Why are you following him everywhere? When we went up, because I'm in the middle of making a documentary with this guy, and when we went up to his house, he had been bugged. A bug was found in his house. And like you say, there is royalty involved. There's no two ways about it. Everyone is involved, the hierarchy. That was their playground. They'd done what they wanted to do. I believe that there's going to be a big name coming out this weekend. I hope it's coming out, because I've been promised by the national media that it's been coming out for a few weeks. But there is a guy that I've been working with in the national media, and he's a good guy. If they don't name, right, this high cabinet minister, right, who's in Margaret Thatcher's time, very, very powerful man. If they don't name it this weekend, I'll name it next week. How's that? I'll come on your show and I'll name this bastard who done it. Because I've got a list that would bring this country to its knees.
You know, it's like a female politician that no one, they won't name, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I can't name who
I know,
she, who
I
she
know,
was.
I know, but so, most people have got it.
Well, I'll tell you what.
Most people have got it.
Yeah, but you know, when paedophilia, you know what I mean, this subject, when it starts affecting what you're eating and what you're not, you know, I can't eat a curry anymore.
Well, Gary, your fans cut across all age groups and include Patricia Neal and the late Roald Dahl. You were introduced to them by their daughter, and she is here, yes. Tessa Dahl.
Tessa. I'm sorry.
Tessa, were you impressed from the very beginning?
Oh, always greatly impressed. Oh. Gary actually came to live in my house when he was between jobs. And,
yeah, but I was absolutely broke.
My sister Lucy turned it into quite a successful venture because she used to pack the train full of her adolescent school friends in school uniform and they'd Skype school and she'd bring them up to the house and charge them £5 a head to come and gaze at glitter. And my sister Lucy turned it into quite a successful venture because she used to pack the train full of her adolescent school friends in school uniform and they'd Skype school and she'd bring them up to the house and charge them £5 a head to come and gaze at glitter. Skype school.
First of all, I would like to start by saying that we have an international paedophile ring that's been operating within every democratic government on our planet. There has also been connections to the Middle East all over the world. We're looking at the killing of children. We're going back to just a guy called Sidney Cook, which those that are initiated into this subject will understand. We're looking at the torture of children. We're looking at snuff movies. I'll tell you what happened. One snuff movie, our victim was forced to film a snuff movie, all by Sidney Cook. All, this is our witness, the main witness that has come to us because he doesn't want to go too far now with the police and the secret services, if you like, that are involved. So, you know, this is a very precarious position. We're talking about, and I'm not just talking about in this country, I'm talking about all over the world, every sovereign country, with everywhere. And over the lot, I've been working on it for 6 months now, Lou, and even me, it has rocked me.
Yeah.
It has rocked me to my foundations. I cannot believe the names that are coming out. And as you know, Lou, you know, I've been doing this kind of work for a very long time. So Leon Britton, you know, a witness was attacked and raped by Leon Britton. Leon Britton is the one that they don't want to go for at the moment. Our witness identified Leon Britton by a tattoo that he has on his groin. Our witness threw the tattoo for the police.
The Queen herself has been accused of being involved in abducting children. William Coombs, who's a resident of the Downtown East Side, he's been on my radio show on Co-op Radio a number of times, he described how in October 1964, he remembered it was the fall, and sure enough, I checked, and the Queen and Prince Philip were in Canada between October 5th and 13th of 1964. He said the Queen and Prince Philip showed up at the Kamloops Catholic residential school where he was a student. And he said they took all the children down to the riverside for a picnic, and 10 of the children left with the Queen and Prince Philip and never came back, 7 boys and 3 girls. He said it was really odd because all the kids were from that area, and they were never seen again their entire life.
As were my 7 siblings. So you think of the abuse, whatever depths you can go to, we were there. Now, I specialise in institutional child abuse. I've been talking to a few of you, and I've been doing this for quite a few years now. You know, I went into the dramatic film game to earn the big bucks and to be a filmmaker. But this came back on me when my sister was found dead in her apartment after a documentary film I shot called Sun, Sea and Satan. And in Sun, Sea and Satan, I am accusing the establishment, the institutions and the Crown of killing my sister. Now, when I was making Sun, Sea and Satan, when I was shooting this film on the island of Jersey, it's about Hope de la Garenne, where there was a massive establishment cover-up and many of the children were being killed. I don't know if you remember, they found teeth in the cellar and bits and pieces of kids lying about and victims giving statements that were ignored and are still ignored. And there was a newspaper article in the Irish World yesterday about me, and it said that I was going to commit treason. Well, if saying that I have a victim underneath your man here, if I say telling you people here in the middle of Trafalgar Square that I have a very reliable victim who is a witness on the island of Jersey who told me in detail how the Queen Mother used to play about with her. Yes, I can see you. And this is what you're all here for. You're all here for the Crown. You're all here, all you tourists, you're all here to say, what a wonderful country, we've got a wonderful queen. Well, what you don't know is that the Queen owns the island of Jersey. The UK does not own the island of Jersey, it is the Queen. Our Queen owns the island of Jersey. It has a population of just 90,000, 90. Yet it has a financial industry worth £250 billion per year. She has not taken any, and I can see one of the wardens looking at me, because what I am doing here is committing treason. Now, it was up to 1998 that the only law in this country, not killing children, raping children, torturing children, no death penalty for that. But in 1998, we still had a death penalty in this country for treason. Now, treason means something as simple as this: talking bad against the royal family. Well, if we've got any police officers here, I'm accusing the Queen Mother of paedophilia. And I am accusing her daughter, of covering it up on her island of Jersey. And so, this is a dirty country. This country is filthy because of our Queen and her mother and Mr. Lord Mountbatten, who, when he was killed, had 3 children on his boat with him. That's how high it goes. And now, another little bit of sinister story for you. The Pope, the age of sexual consent in the Pope's Vatican City up to 1 year ago, 2009, was just 12. 12. You can take a kid at 12 years of age in the Vatican City. Then, when our film, Sun, Sea and Satan, was released, they put it up last year to 14. You have 800 priests, clergymen, that live in the Vatican City. Nobody else lives there or stays there. They are celibate. Now, celibacy means you don't have sex.
Why do they need an age of consent if they don't have sex? And I'm very angry. I'm very angry.
Good evening. BBC South East Today has discovered that the Church of England has conducted a secret investigation into a former Sussex bishop who is also a close friend of Prince Charles. The Right Reverend Peter Ball has close ties to the royal family and was the Bishop of Lewes for 15 years.
But he resigned in disgrace in 1993 after committing an act of gross indecency against a teenager. We now understand that a dossier of information about the bishop has been sent to Sussex Police for review. Our Home Affairs correspondent Colin Campbell has the exclusive story.
With great penitence and sorrow, the circumstances that have led to this police caution.
After his resignation, the bishop was provided with a grace and favour home in Somerset by Prince Charles. He also read a homily at the funeral of Camilla Parker Bowles' father in 2006. Now 80, Bishop Peter Ball continued working in churches until 2010. In a statement, Sussex Police told us the reports and files they've received relate to matters more than 20 years ago and that the contents will be reviewed in order to establish whether any police investigation of possible criminal offences would be merited.
Elizabeth actually agreed to place all Anglican clergy under the Catholic policy known as crimen solicitanus. That basically orders Anglican priests now, along with Catholic priests, to cover up child abuse. What she just did by that was violated her coronation oath, to where she swore to protect the citizens of England. She has agreed now to cover up child rape. This is like an official criminal conspiracy. And naturally, us exposing that puts them in a really dangerous position. She should, under British law now, be forced to abdicate, she and all her heirs, because she's, completely committed treason, in effect. Now, their backs are obviously to the wall on this, and they are now obviously getting some advice that I should be permanently silenced, because in order to stop this, which could lead to a whole chain of events which could topple the whole British monarchy. So, I'm not surprised in a way they're acting that way, but they've been striking at people around me as well. If you remember, three of our members over the last little while have been put in British or Canadian prisons on trumped-up charges. One man was put in a mental hospital for 3 days until we got him out. The fellow in London, David Compan. So, they've been heating around us, but definitely this is aimed at trying to, stop this exposure of the direct link between the Vatican and the Crown.
Are you aware of living paedophiles currently encircling Parliament?
Oh, yes. There are several in Parliament at the moment.
Right.
And they're being blackmailed.
They they are being blackmailed.
And it's a problem.
And by whom would they be blackmailed?
Well, it all goes back to Germany. The German intelligence are the classic users of paedophiles. Mm. The Germans understand paedophilia very well. Not saying all Germans paedophiles, but...
Obviously.
The German intelligence have always understood paedophilia. And they've also had a good understanding of human nature and human weakness. It partly goes back to Freud, who was one of their intelligence advisors. He was one of their psychiatric advisors. The Germans have always had brothels, male brothels, in England. In the 1930s, they had three. There was one in Oxford, one in Cambridge, and one in London.
Right.
And they also had female brothels as well. And
interesting dispersal there, really, isn't it?
Well, yes, and it's not... London is the centre of power. Oxford and Cambridge are the centres of education, or were then. And, of course, what the Germans are doing is spotting future leaders.
Right.
Edward Heath was recruited at Oxford. He was recruited at Balliol
right.
in 1937.
Right.
Edward Heath first met Adolf Hitler in 1937.
Years old. I'm the oldest one from the whole family, and it's a church ritual from what is in the Bible. The first born should be offered to God, and that was what they did to me when I was 4 years old. Put me on my stomach on the table. And the vicar, he put his fingers in my vagina, and it was bleeding. And then my grandfather did it, not with his fingers, but with his penis, and all they were singing, and... My uncle did the same, and it took an hour before they were ready in the hole. It was a white blanket for I was on laying, but it was totally red. My grandfather, he paid the figure for this. I had to go more than once a week to my grandfather's house to have myself abused by him. And then he raped me. And also my uncle did the same to me. He tried to bring you, to put you in a position that you are unable to do things, and to make your
feel guilty.
Yeah, feel guilty. When I was 5 years old, the house doctor did come, who always also gave me the pills when after the ritual, and he learned my. Or I teach my parents how to torture me with electricity. Then he bound me on the table and gave me electricity through my fingers or hands and feet. And afterwards, when that was done, I was always naked. He stimulated the clitoris to give me a clitoral orgasm. So torturing and orgasm should go together. And that was, he came 3 times to teach my parents that, and it was my mother who had to do it.
So your mother used to give you an orgasm?
Yeah.
Stimulate you?
Yeah.
Your mother was sexually abusing you too?
Yeah. My mother trained me, and it was a training for the Freemasons, it's an examination, a kind of examination, if they will come through or not, if they are really
pedophile or... So it's initiation.
Yeah.